Okay, good morning.
Good morning,
members of the audience. On behalf of the Department of English, University of Gurgaon, this is your host, Amit Bhattacharya, welcoming you to another session of the online lecture series that we are organizing. In view of the COVID-19 pandemic situation, the academic activities have migrated online, and in order to supplement the teaching efforts of our faculty members and also in order to give the much needed academic exposure to our students and scholars, we are organizing this fest of ideas. Today we are really very happy to have in our midst one of the seminal minds of our day. Actually, I am really very pleased to welcome Daya Dishanayake, the eminent Sri Lankan novelist, blogger, poet and thinker, who is with us today. And today he is going to talk about a very, very relevant subject. He has given the title to his presentation in this way: Conflict, Peace and Harmony Through Literature. Before I hand over the reins of this program to Dayaji, I must tell you something about Daya Dishanayake. He is the proud recipient of the Sri Lankan State Literary Award for the Best English Language Novel twice, for Kadvita in 1998, for The Eavesdropper in 2007, and for A Miracle Under Kumbhakri in 2013. He has also received the Shark Literary Award. So we are really very pleased to have him with us today. And in today's world, torn asunder by jingoistic muscle flexing, I think what he has chosen to talk about makes immense sense. So without further ado, let me now request Daya Dishanayake ji to address our students and scholars and the members of this august audience. Over to you, Daya.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello. Namaskar.
Yes, you are audible.
Namaskar, and thank you, Professor Amit Bhattacharya, for inviting me to give this talk, and I'm really honored and proud to be able to do this here. And let me start briefly. Conflicts occur frequently because animals of the same species have very similar requirements for their well-being, survival and reproduction, and their demand for those resources exceed what is available. Animals also compete with each other for access to mates, social status, food, and parental care. The conflict may be direct with animals fighting each other, or indirect with animals competing without fighting each other directly, but then it becomes exploitation. Both forms of competition can be harmful. Fighting can result in injury or death. Even if animals aren't directly harmed by others, they can be harmed by deprivation. We face many different forms of conflicts, but today we are limiting our talk to conflict among human beings, which leads to violence, destruction of life, peace, and harmony. War is really wrong because war is something totally unnecessary and something found only among human beings. We have no other animals who are fighting like this. And war is legal murder. It's state-sponsored murder, rape, plunder and destruction, but always justified by the victim. It's the loser who is always wrong, who is the villain, and the winner is the hero, will always have enough reasons, arguments, evidence to justify his mass murder, rape and enslavery of the victims. Hitler was the villain, while Churchill received the Nobel Prize 1953 for literature. Had Hitler won, would he have been awarded the Nobel for literature for Mein Kampf? We are always happy to drown ourselves in meaningless words, just to fool ourselves. One such word is peace. There would have been no peace on earth ever since man became a greedy, arrogant, anthropocentric creature who became androcentric later. He murdered the Mother Goddess, who showed infinite loving kindness to all life on earth. In her place, he created a god in his own image, who justified all of man's evil, destructive actions. Our mother is Earth Mother, Mother Earth, which is also our motherland. Vasudeva Kutumbakam. Currently, we don't have any peace, harmony or order, not only in South Asia, but the whole world. We do not have any peace anywhere. What we try to fool ourselves with is the condition which could be called simply the absence of war, like we have in Sri Lanka since 2009, after the 30-year war was ended. We try to bring peace and ahimsa by force. Even the United Nations sent peacekeeping forces into conflict regions. India sent a peacekeeping force to Sri Lanka to bring peace by force. In the beginning, there would not have been any violence. There would not have been a word for violence. Our greed led to human-human conflict, which led to violence over the past several millennia. We are so proud about our evolution and progress of our civilizations that we do not even have a word for the absence of violence. We only have negative words like ahimsa or non-violence. That's probably because we cannot even imagine a condition without any violence. Animals in the natural habitat, without any pressure or interference from man, do not show any violence. They only show aggression when predators hunt for their food or when they act in defense. And to be shared and shared alike. Mother Earth provides the nourishment and shelter to all animal beings, her children. All animals eat only when they are hungry, except when there is overcrowding or a famine. There would not be a shortage of food, even when they could migrate, could imagine a location for their plentiful food. And talking about the history of violence, most things do not happen as they should. And some things do not happen at all. It is the business of the conscientious historian to correct these defects. This quote is attributed to Mark Twain. Though I am not a historian, may I give my version of our history, how I believe history should have happened. I believe that nature domesticated human animals, first by domesticating the woman. It was she who gathered food and nursed the children. She had to go in search of food, water, and shelter. Nature showed her the most suitable sites, and she decided to settle down in such a place for a longer period. Then she made the male, male of the species, to settle down with her. That is how man was domesticated, along with other animals like cows and goats and dogs. Domestication of plants would have been accidental. When a woman noticed a new plant growing from a seed of a fruit she had thrown away, she noticed it only after she settled down in one place. She realized that if she could grow her own plants, she did not have to go in search of food. And that is when conflicts began. A woman came to consider a particular tree as her own because she had planted it. Next came the claim of the plot of earth where the tree was growing. It became her property. In a neighborhood, if her neighbor plucked the fruit from this tree, it caused the first property dispute. It shattered the peace and harmony. The situation aggravated when the male stepped into the dispute. The first mistake made by the woman was to let men get involved in the conflict of possession. The men took over not only the trees and the plot of land, but also the household. For the woman, her wealth was her children. For the man, the wealth became the property, trees, land, and the harvest. Next, he began to consider the woman and children too as his property. Possession led to greed and envy. Religious had to lay down commandments. Thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's property and thy neighbor's wife. As long as this greed continued, conflict and violence will never allow peace and harmony. And man changed the tools used by the woman into weapons. Hunter-gatherer is one of the biggest myths promoted by Western scholars. In the beginning, a man would have been a vegetarian. There would have been plenty of food, fresh food, not only for humans, but for all the animals around them. When the food sources began to dry up, they could always move to a fresh habitat without any hesitation. They had nothing to carry with them because they did not need any material goods. Anything they needed was always at hand. They did not have any need to possess anything to be called their own. They knew that everything on Mother Earth belonged to all life and they respected it. In addition to the fruits and nuts, they would also have consumed edible tubers. To dig up the tubers, they would have used a stick snapped off a tree. It was this digging tool or digging stick that our anthropologists identified as a weapon to kill animals, as a spear. The pointed fragment of wood found in Clacton on the Sea in England. It has been interpreted by most scholars as a deliberately fashioned spear point, but it would equally well be the fragment of a 300,000-year-old digging stick. A digging stick would have been used by a woman and probably made by her, not to kill animals, but to dig up a tube. Very recently, a team of anthropologists, archaeologists discovered a few sharpened bone points in Sri Lanka at the Fayan cave. They immediately decided these were arrowheads and people in Lanka had used bows and arrows 40,000 years ago. These in a country where no cave paintings have been found with any hunting scenes or violence against other human beings. If the people were vegetarian, why did they own bows and arrows? Have they found any evidence of human-human conflict or violence against man? It was man's greed which continued to increase over the years, which placed man against man, brother against brother. And so we also find the story of Cain and Abel, or the bloodthirsty Alexander to invade, murder, and occupy other lands. The Western warmongers called him Alexander the Great. Closer home, we have heard of the Mahabharata war and about sending Rama into exile. The greed to grab what belonged to another by force or by fraud became a part of man's nature and his culture. A few men who were morally more greedy, more cunning, used the other innocent men in their community as their tool to grab what belongs to the neighboring community. And this came worse among mankind, the institutionalized mass murder and violence. Men who had used torture and killing for innocent animals found it easier to kill their own people because of the hatred roused in them by their leaders and the opportunity to pillage and plunder. Though we are made to believe that we evolved to be a more cultured and civilized history has proved that always it's the invader who was less civilized and less cultured. We are parasites living on the crust of Mother Earth. We are like ticks on the skin of an animal. And we think the animals belongs to us, whether we live on its tail or the legs or the ears. We try to invade, kill the ticks on another part of the body and occupy it. But the ticks have an advantage. When the animal dies of tick fever, the ticks can jump to another animal. When we destroy Mother Earth, we have nowhere else to go. We have got used to believing and accepting that violence is not the means and necessary to violence. Throughout history, there never had been a justifiable war. All wars had been fought by men who were greedy for more. There may have been a few instances where men had fought over water or food, but that too would have been out of greed because any natural source could be shared. Mother Nature always had enough for us to share. And violence takes many forms in addition to physical violence. Depriving another person of his food too is a violent act. We are all guilty of such violence because we are depriving the starving millions around the world of their rightful share of food available. We are guilty of overconsumption and criminal wastage of food. UNICEF figures for chronic undernourishment in 2016 were 795 million people, or 1 in 9 of the world population. We have deprived them of their rightful share of food. The famine in 1943 was a most unfortunate example for which the British should accept responsibility. The Kolkata writer and poet Bob de Costa posted a poem on Facebook recently, Diary of a Dalit Girl. What is your desire, the girl said, to get a husband who won't beat me and to eat rice every day? This poem says it all, not just about the young Dalit girl, but about all suppressed and oppressed life on earth. It's not only the Dalit wife who gets beaten or starves. None of us want to be beaten by anyone, physically or mentally. Just as a husband could beat his wife, the wife too could hit back by abusing him, torturing him mentally, or cheating on him. The husband would beat not only the wife, but the children too, and his younger siblings, both boys and girls. The wife in turn could take it out on her children, the children on their younger brothers and sisters. In a well-to-do family, the wife would beat the female domestic servant, even deprive her of her food. While we talk about violence on women, can we close our eyes and ears about violence by women? A child who suffered domestic violence could become a sadistic warmonger as he grew up. We need peace and harmony at home too, before we seek peace around the world. A major issue is religious conflict, fighting each other for the love of the same God. Religion has been used by people greedy for wealth and power throughout history, even though violence would have evolved before religions. By religions, I mean the revealed religions or the Abrahamic religions and the Eastern philosophies, which were made into pseudo-religions by the Europeans, who tried to group our traditions along with their religions. People like Max Weber created the isms, Hinduism, Jainism, and Buddhism, destroying our Vishwadhamma. That's probably why Jesus had to say, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, pray for those who mistreat you. In the Holy Quran, we find, don't hate other people, treat everyone fairly. Let not hatred of any people seduce you that you deal not justly. Deal justly. And the Prophet said, God grants to Rifq what he does not grant to Anf. And Jonathan said, we have just enough religion to make us hate, but not enough to love one another. Religions, including our South Asian Dharma, became the most convenient tool for those who were hungering for wealth and power. I am an agnostic. I believe that if there is a God, a one God, a supreme God, we must try to find one name for that God, acceptable to all humans. If this supreme God created all life on earth, including humans, then we are all his children. We, all living beings, are siblings of one family, sabbe sapta. Here too we have a problem with words. God, for those who believe in revealed religions, is supreme, omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. Unfortunately, the Europeans translated our term Deva as God, confusing us as they confused themselves. The hatred which arose among different groups of the children of the same God, they brought to the people of Asia, thus creating religious conflicts, struggles, battles and genocides in our part of the world. If we are all the children of the God, the Father, then as his children, we would not need an intermediary to talk to him or seek his advice or his blessings. It's the agent, representative, intermediary who came between the Father and the Son, God and man, and created conflict. And we also come across a term called nation. The concept of nation contradicts the concept of humanity. It is an illusion created by the colonials. A nation does not give the people autonomy, freedom, independence, or whatever other illusions created during the colonial period. In South Asia, we cannot even find an equivalent word for nation. Even the English did not have a concept of a nation till 1300 CE. The concept of a nation is a curse upon mankind. Identifying oneself with one group by nationality, flag, language, dress code, or political views alienates us from the others outside the group. As Mahakavi Rabindranath had written in a letter in 1921, "I love India. But my India is an idea and not a geographical expression. Therefore, I am not a patriot. I shall seek my compatriots all over the world." And he also said, "We should achieve the unity of man by destroying the bondage of nationalism." We talk of a national language when there are 6,900 different languages today. Then perhaps we should consider there are 6,900 nations in the world. There are over 800 different languages used in New York. We could call New York City a United Nation. In India, there are 398 listed live languages, with newspapers published in 87 languages and 58 languages taught in schools around the country. If each different language group wanted to establish their own nation, in the same manner the Tamil Tigers wanted to do in Sri Lanka, it would mean 398 different nations in India. Our countries have existed for many thousand years without a national anthem or a national flag. No one was concerned about a national language. It's not an anthem or a flag which unites a people or which creates patriotic feelings. It's a sense of belonging, sense of loyalty that creates this unity. Like we have the unity and loyalty in our family, to our parents, our siblings, and our children, in our part of the world, even to an extended family. There's a lot we can learn from King Asoka, Devanampriya Piyadasi Asoka Raja. He was one king that India forgot or ignored after his death. He was brought back to life by the Buddhists as Asoka, and the Lankan Pali Chronicles called him a Buddhist. And this alienated him from all other traditions, religious faiths. And then he was reintroduced to India by Europeans as a heroic warmonger to be taken up later by the Indians fighting for independence. If we can clear our minds of the legends and myths built up around Asoka, and try to concentrate on his inscriptions, there is a lot we can learn from him. He could show us how we can solve most of the conflicts raging around the world today and live in peaceful coexistence with all livings, with nature. He said, "For Devanampriya desires towards all beings abstention from hurting, self-control, and impartiality in case of violence. And he said obedience to parents is important. And liberality towards friends, acquaintances, and relatives means accepting them as they are, respecting their views, feelings, and practices. Help and contribute towards their efforts, rejoice in their success, and support in their times of need or distress. Swami Vivekananda said, we should learn to accept instead of simply trying to tolerate. Acceptance of others, their culture, traditions, and beliefs would bring real harmony. Whether or not Ashoka had waged the war against the Kalingas, we have to accept that he had administrated by peaceful means the vast empire put together by his grandfather and father, by violence and the force of arms. He did not use violence in administration, instead of which he managed the land and kept it together by non-violent measures for the 37 years he ruled. This is what our leaders today should explore, how to run a country without using violence and without using fear to subdue his people. Why do we need armed forces to run a country, or for defense, or for offense? It is this mission, Ashoka, that we have to understand through his inscriptions and learn how to apply them successfully today, so people could mingle with the gods when all human beings too would be good in their thoughts and their actions. I'll speak some of the other things about Ashoka. And about armed forces, about Iceland, the US travel advisory last year reported, crime continues to be lower than in most developed countries and countries of similar size and demographics. The low level of general crime and very low level of violent crime due to the high standard of living, lack of tension between social and economic classes, small population, strong social attitudes against criminality, high level of trust in law enforcement, and a well-trained, highly educated police force. The Iceland police do not carry guns, and the country does not have an army. We have to look at peaceful means of attaining peace and harmony, not by force. A Buddhist monk from Thailand explained Buddha Dhamma in four words: be peaceful and useful. And we can reach peacefulness and usefulness through Subhashita Sahitya. We as writers can be useful to bring the message of peace and harmony to all life on Mother Earth. But for this purpose, we have to give up becoming mercenaries, writing to earn filthy lucre, or for the purpose of winning literary awards. Let us ignore one more misused term, literature. Let us go back to our more meaningful term, sahitya, to bring about a Vishwa Sahitya. And our main theme should be humanity, how to bring back humanness to humanity. There cannot be any discrimination among human beings. We have to regain our lost humanism by becoming human once again. There are many things we have to do, many things we have to give up, many things that we have to accept. And let us begin our journey now. Even if we are unable to achieve the goal, our children will definitely achieve it. We have to do away with all labels: religions, races, castes, the concept of nations, national anthems, flags. And as Musharraf H. Khan at the New York University says, war news and books would be considered as pornography of violence. He has also argued that war in modern times, like festivals in primitive societies, demands human sacrifice. When we see all news media, the tragedy of the children killed in the Gaza Strip, it just shows that children are the ones easy to sacrifice or kill. Gaza is the most recent reminder of the ghastliness of war, but it is what has been happening ever since man began to fight his own brother. They kill not only the men, but the women and children, and they rape the women and take them as slaves. The rulers offer all these benefits to their armies as an inducement, along with whatever wealth they could plunder from the enemy. In the beginning, creative art forms would have evolved to relieve a creative urge and then would have been appreciated by others, which may later on have led to development of such arts into a form of innocent, pure entertainment. It could also have been a means of transferring knowledge and experience. There would not have been any ulterior motives of material benefits or dominance. At the time, there would have been only peace and harmony and loving kindness towards all life in creative art too. Today, man is exposed to too much violence in all the media and most of the literature. And that is what makes man to become more violent and also become immune to acts of violence. Why people cannot empathize or at least sympathize with the victims of violence. The saddest situation is the exposure of our children to violence in children's literature and mass media. In most of the children's books too, there are bad people who commit illegal, often violent acts. The criminals are caught and often given violent punishment. Society is trying to control violence by using violence. Today, the violent literature and films have conditioned our minds to enjoy when we see one bad person cause injury to another person. Then the hero punishes the villain. We enjoy both acts. We enjoy today what we would not want done to ourselves. Violence always breeds further violence. And when vengeance too becomes part of human culture, the situation becomes worse. First, there would not have been a need to slap another person or to receive a slap. Even if a person received a slap, he would bear it in silence. Then from turning the other cheek to hitting back, and then instead of an eye for an eye, man sought both eyes for one eye. And then the entire head. Many writers and actors play on man's inherent weakness of greed, envy, and lust, and the desire for violence. That is unfortunate. And René Girard said, violence always seems to be mingled with desire. Professor Emeritus of Stanford University, René Girard said in Deceit, Desire and the Novel, Self and Others in Literary Structure. He said, desire is the general force behind violence and the snake that turns friends and lovers into rivals. In fiction and films, stories thrive on conflict between characters because man does not know what to choose. He looks at others and he wants what the other is having. Homes. When many people desire the same things, desire, jealousy and rivalry provide perfect themes for great novelists. And as long as man is a slave to his own cravings, mimetic desires will control him and the society in which he lives. Creators of fiction and films and big business will continue to exploit it, and they use violence in their creative works to attract more customers. And we have to, when writers and producers took to providing cheap entertainment to their readers and their audience to cater to their sexual desires, producing erotica, that next inevitable step was sexual violence. Mass media and social media keep on raping the raped till they find the next victim. We are all responsible for the plight of all Nirbhayas in the world. Reading about sexual deviation, sadomasochism, and watching them on screen creates temptations, which would be one of the reasons for the increase in such forms of violence in our society today. The mass media who report such incidents in graphic detail would also be contributing to such an increase in sexual violence. It had taken 152 years for the sale of 2 million copies of A Tale of Two Cities, and needed only 57 years to reach 157 years for Lord of the Rings. Da Vinci Code sold 80 million in 8 years. When the novel and the film have become a commodity, the businessman took over, and he wants to get the highest sale and the highest profits in the shortest time. He encourages the writers to write such books full of violence and erotic fantasies, and the readers get addicted, thus creating a vicious circle from which he would never be able to break out. The violent novel gives ideas to terrorists. One instance is the suicide bomber. Craig Thomas, in his 1976 novel Rat Trap, mentions a woman who explodes herself inside the packed dance hall during the World War II. The Last Jihad by Joel Rosenberg was on the New York Times bestseller list for 11 weeks because it was a story of a hijacked jet on a suicide attack on the president's motorcade. This book was written 9 months before 9/11, and Tom Clancy's Debt of Honor, which had a vengeful man planning to fly a plane into Capitol Hill, was published 9 years earlier. Same way, Stephen Leather's thriller Soft Target, about a plot to export bombs in the London Underground, was published 5 months before the July 7, 2005 terrorist attack in London. We have terrorists and the novelist working on the same mindset. I have always believed that we can learn from any kind of fiction if we read them with an open mind and if we can pause to think. Sahid's Widow by Daniel Barr is a novel I would consider as one of the best anti-terrorism novels I have read. I saw the story through my exposure to terrorism and suicide bombing in Sri Lanka during the Tamil terrorism 30 years, and more recent Easter Sunday attack on Catholic churches in Sri Lanka by a terrorist group. And Danny Barr's novel is about a widow of such a Shahid. By Shahid, he would have meant the suicide bombers in the story or the young man who sacrificed himself to prevent a massacre. And there are many widows around all over the world. They are suffering because of man's violence against man. Today, in the present world of violence, where a widow could be the wife of a person who had died or whose husband had gone missing, whether in an act of terrorism or in state-sponsored violence, it could also be sometimes a girlfriend or mistress of such a person, where she would not even have any legal claim as a widow. In Sri Lanka, there are an estimated 90,000 war widows in the Tamil community from the 30 years war, and 9,684 military widows. None of them would have wanted their husbands to die or kill husbands and children of other women. We also have an unaccounted number of unwed mothers who had conceived and produced children, sometimes to escape conscription by the terrorists. There is a novel published last year in Sri Lanka about the tragic situation of such war widows, Innocent Victims, by Siva Aruran. then there is also the John Rambo effect. The John Rambo character became a prominent part of pop culture, and Rambo, a word that can function as a noun, adjective, or a verb, became part of the English language. Rambo is a word that can be found in prestigious English dictionaries. We have adjectives such as Rambosque, Ramboid, or Ramboism. And President Reagan stated at a press conference, "Boy, after seeing Rambo First Blood 2 last night, I know what to do next time this happens." Reagan often refers to Rambo First Blood 2 as a model for his domestic and foreign policies. David Morrell, a professor of American literature at the University of Iowa, published his novel First Blood in 1972. Since then, he has written 28 novels, translated into 30 languages, and is the co-president of the International Thriller Writers Organization. For the sake of world peace, harmony, and ahimsa, he should have stopped with First Blood and continued teaching literature against violence. I consider it probably the best anti-war novel of the 20th century. Morrell had been inspired by the stories of his students who had been victims of the Vietnam War, many of them suffering from PTSD. John Scott of Time described it as pornography, that is, extended or excessive scenes of carnage, violence, and gore. That is how we should describe the film Rambo, which earned $125,000 million, leading to the production of the series, earning filthy lucre for the writer and the producer. As long as our literature and films continue to feed such pornography, Homo sapiens will continue to kill each other till we annihilate our entire species, as I have predicted in my novel, Clone, a historical novel from the future. Violent literature and pornography could be one reason for the spread of all forms of violence, political, religious, domestic, and sexual. The word we could use is Durbhashita literature. Instead of what we need is Subhashita Sahitya and other creative arts. The conflicts are all caused because we all try to flaunt our race, religion, language, or country through our literature. We are like children. Most of us have not grown up even when we grow old. We still believe our country is better, bigger and powerful than yours. Our language is better and older. Our religion is better or is the only true religion. Let us grow up. Let us accept all other human beings as our brothers and sisters. If we believe that we are the highest evolved, most intelligent animals on earth, then let us rise above other animal beings. Let us use our creative talents and learn from the animals how to live in harmony with other creatures and with nature. There cannot be more equal people on earth. If we are to aim towards total reconciliation and peaceful coexistence, we need to begin with our children. Let the state do away with labels like race and religion in all records. Let us all be human beings. Let there be no segregation in schools by race or religion. Let our children study together, play together, and grow up like brothers and sisters. If religion is to be taught in schools, let students learn about all major religions, the true religions where there is only love and not hatred and violence. Then they will understand each other and will not allow any room for pseudo-fanatics to brainwash the innocent young people into hating each other and resorting to violence. I read a great short story recently, When the World Lost Its Marbles, by Santosh Bakaya, about a story based in Kashmir, which won the Bharat Award for Literature 2020. We have another unfortunate situation about the partition and partisan literature. 72 years after the British created the partition, we still produce partisan literature. We hold conferences on partisan literature. Almost all the victims and victimizers are dead and gone, or too old to even remember the incidents. All we are trying to do is keep the sad, horrible memories alive, to keep the fires of hatred alive for our grandchildren and great-grandchildren. It is this undying hatred which turns the victims to become victimizers. It is what we find in the Arab-Israeli conflict today. It is continuing in a never-ending cycle. Victims become victimizers and becoming the next victims. We writers should write about harmony and coexistence and about the good side of mankind, about loving kindness. Let us not make heroes out of our murderers, but bring out true heroes who try to bring peace and who prevents war and conflicts. The most recent heroic deed was by Pope Francis kissing the feet of the Sudanese leaders, pleading for peace. Let us all hope the leaders will heed the Pope and end the war that has killed over 400,000 human beings already. 800 years ago, St. Francis of Assisi risked his life to visit the camp of Al-Malik Al-Kamil in an attempt to end the killing during the Fifth Crusade. I would like to repeat, man is the only animal on earth who is violent, who murders his own species. Animals never show violence against their own. In that case, man is the lowest evolved, most wild, sadistic creature on earth. Yet if man believes he is the highest evolved, most intelligent, most learned animal with powers of rational thinking, he should be able to convince the gullible young people to turn away from violence, that man is capable of using intelligence, language skills and reasoning powers to resolve all and all issues, conflicts, misunderstandings without turning to violence. Let us use all media and social media to bring about peace and harmony. It is said that one man caused the world wars in the 20th century, followed by the Cold War. His name was Gavrilo Princip, a 19-year-old Serb nationalist who assassinated Austria's Archduke Franz Ferdinand and his wife 100 years ago on June 28, 1914. The First World War caused the death of over 13 million of the armed forces. Even when the war ended in November 1918, no one really won the war. The peace treaty of Versailles led to the World War II, which resulted in the death of over 50 million. And we are still fighting the same wars. And sometimes flags start a war and are always used in war. We should do away with our flags, which only divide people. Buddha Dhamma survived around the world for 2,400 years without the need of a flag. It's an American who came to Sri Lanka and claimed to have converted himself to Buddhism, who decided that the Buddhists needed a flag. I do not understand how and why people should convert from one religion to another. We do not convert from one race to another, or one nationality to another. I admire and love India, but I cannot convert myself to be an Indian. The origin of flags should never have happened, and because of war and human armed conflicts. And that's why we should do away with these flags. The flag waving only widens the gap between religions and races. The flag is a symbol of superiority, aggression, proclamation of victory or the vanquished. Such behavior should never be part of any religious movement or a national movement. Identifying oneself with one group by flag, language, dress code, or political views alienates us from the others outside the group. All over the world, we adopt, imitate, copy customs, rituals, and way of life from other cultures, religions, and languages. Yet we try to still isolate ourselves within our own man-made barriers and try to fight with those on the other side. I would like to touch briefly on the conflict in Sri Lanka, which led to a 30-year genocide. But because of time constraints, probably next time we'll try to join. Thank you for listening and thank you for tolerating my views. Namaskar.
Am I audible?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Okay. Thank you, Dayaji, for such an enthralling presentation. It's good that we waited, braved the technical hitches, and it has been a very, very exhilarating experience for the audience. And without any wastage of more time, I would like to open the session for questions and comments.
Yes, thank you, and thank you, Professor Amit. And I welcome any questions. Anyway, nobody will have to agree with what I said, and I am ready to respond any way about my ideas. Thank you.
Thank you for wonderful talk. We are waiting for the questions to come into the chat box, or if anybody has questions.
You can ask me questions now, or you can always contact me on WhatsApp or on email, and I will be happy to respond in any way I can for any questions, any doubts, or any things where you may not agree with what I said.
Yes, Dr. Soumipendra Banerjee will be the moderator. Dr. Soumipendra Banerjee, Vivek Odhikari, and Shobhu Sarkar, my colleagues who have been with us. And Dr. Soumipendra Banerjee will moderate the questions. So you are all requested to send in your questions, type them in the chat box, and it will be read out.
Yes, I'm trying to do that. So far, I have received questions. Yes, okay, the first question has come. K.P. Parmar wants to know please elaborate why consider our spiritual literature as literature worthy of academic research. Sir, did you get the question?
Hello. What's the question, please?
Hello. Yeah, did you get? Yeah, I'll repeat it.
Okay.
Why do not we consider our spiritual literature as worthy of academic research?
No, I had never said anything like that. Our spiritual literature should be studied, should deserve more academic research, but from the viewpoint of humanity, from humans, from loving kindness. We should try to interpret our spiritual literature also as literature of loving kindness. Like Mahatma Gandhi said, with his book on Bhagavad Gita. We should study our spiritual literature, but we should not allow people to distort our spiritual literature to create hatred among mankind. That's what I meant. Because that is what is happening. Almost all religious literature has been distorted and has been quoted out of context to create conflicts. We should avoid that. The only way to avoid that is by studying the entire literature and reading it in context. Okay.
Yes. Any other questions?
Another question from Imran. Yes, another question from Imran Ali. Is there a way in which we can reduce violence to control human emotions?
Yeah, that's what I was trying to say.
Is
that
there any way
media...
in which we can
what I tried to mention is that our mass media and social media and our literature are promoting violence. So that is what is preventing people from becoming empathetic. They don't feel pain of others. They enjoy the pain of others. So that we have to moderate our literature and our mass media to bring the pain, to make people feel the pain of others, not just to enjoy the pain created by some people. Because that is how the victims become victimizers, because of the hatred they are made to continue against those who victimize them. So they in turn become victimizers, and this cycle continues.
Yes, thank you, sir. Priyanka Chakraborty asks, how far can we really accept the Subhashita Sahitya to the modern people of the society nowadays?
Well, it cannot be.
Shall we really welcome it in our lives?
Yeah, we cannot do it overnight, but we have to do it gradually.
Yes.
One way we can do is we can try to read Subhashita Sahitya even in the existing literary works. That's why I mentioned a few books like this First Blood by David Morrell. Now, that was taken as a violent book and promoting literature, but I interpret as a really good anti-war novel. That is how we should try to interpret all our literature, even our epics. We should try to understand from a humanistic point of view. And gradually we can do it, and we should start it with the children's books. We should have children's books where we don't describe so much violence, but we describe the humaneness, the loving kindness, and for children to encourage them to love nature, love animals, love the plant life around them, then automatically they will start loving each other. That's what I want to emphasize.
Very.
So commodified literature, we cannot stop.
Sir,
commodified literature.
Whom has a notion of the
nation's concept. But in our part of the world, we didn't have a concept of nation.
I'll just complete the question.
Yeah. Yes, I can read the question here, Nobita Anjan's question.
Yes,
Nations manage the affairs of humanity will be impossible. Yeah. Okay, but how did South Asia, how did the subcontinent survive and manage for so many millennia until the Europeans came? How did we manage without the concept of a nation? Is there any reference to a nation before the Europeans came? And do we have a word for nation in any of our languages? That's because we didn't have that concept, and I don't think we need it even now. It only creates conflict and only creates violence against each other, and people are just grouped into different labels. The nation is an evil. It's not necessary. It's an unnecessary evil. Okay, that's how I believe.
And the last question, Rishika Dave is asking, usually violence is used when the person is not able to explain the way feels to the other person concerned. So is there any other feelings or our thoughts to the other person without resorting to violence?
No, that's because at present, most of us believe that violence has to be responded by violence. Man has been given mouth and language and reasoning power. So why can't we talk about things? Why can't we discuss? Why can't we come to a peaceful solution? Why do we, just because somebody picks up a weapon, why should we pick up a weapon to counter it? Why should we build up armies to counter other armies? Because it never ends. So why can't we try to resolve issues by discussion, by accepting others, by listening to others? We don't even listen to others. We only believe in what we have been told, and we don't even think of the other party. So, yeah, like Rishika Dave had said, the way he feels about the other person. We don't try to understand how the other person feels. Let's try to understand what has made him violent, what has made him angry, and let's see whether we can resolve that. And also, now one issue that I have come across is every year in most part of India, there were beautiful cards being sent by each other, and now by WhatsApp and all other media, Michchami Dukkadam. But why do we have to apologize? Why do we have to ask for forgiveness every year? That is because we continue to do things which needs a forgiveness. So if we can avoid hurting people, then next year we will not have to send messages Michchami Dukkadam. I hope that answers your question, Rishika. Right.
Shirin Jost, a very wonderful but a very important question, I think. Is conflict necessary for peace and inner growth?
Look, conflict, as I said, there are so many different ways that we can interpret the term conflict. But conflict will always be there. But conflict should not leave or develop into violence. Conflict has to be, there will always be conflict, because people, if you take mankind, no two people will agree on the same issue. There will be so many differences of opinion, and people are free to think, free to believe, free to talk the way they want. But that conflict should not lead to violence. We should be able to resolve our conflicts without violence, and then only we can develop peace. And for that, we need inner peace. We have to find peace inside ourselves, inside our homes. Then only we can take peace outside ourselves, outside our homes, into our village, into our city, into our country. So we can't eradicate conflict, but let's accept conflicts and let's try to resolve them.
Yes, sir. Dr. Rajesh Chauhan is in a continuation of your idea on nation. I'll just take the second part. He wants to know how the politicians and statesmen would react if demolish all the geographical boundaries of race and religion, all kinds of boundaries.
Well, as long as there are politicians, as long as there are a few people who are hungry for power and wealth, these things are not possible. We are just dreaming about such situations. But let's hope that someday there will be leaders like King Ashoka. There will be leaders like there will be people who are ready to bring back the Dhamma created by Mahavir or Buddha. And let's see, because do we have to have borders? Do we have to have countries? So, I mean, the concept of United Nations, it never worked the way it should have. But someday, let's hope there will be a global management or administration, and where all people can be equal, and there can be people accepting all races and religions without labels. So humanity originally would not have had any idea of nation. In India, or by India I mean the entire Bharat Desha or the subcontinent. And there would not have been any struggles or any fighting based on nation. So, and race and religion. Religion is something personal. We should not make it an institution, and we should not fight with each other on religion. Let religion be something personal, which we believe, and where we can respect all the others to believe.
Yes, sir. I mean, the next question is from Momita Bala, who wants to talk about the market, basically, brings in the market. So if the novelists are concerned with the selling of their books, how can we stop promoting violence in literature?
Yeah, that is what, because it is because today literature has become a commodity. It's a fast-moving commodity. So producers, the businessmen, they want to sell, they want to make maximum profits. And there are now, David Morrell is a good example. He never would have thought of writing a violent novel and promoting violence. But he was tempted by the income he got from the first film. And it led him to give up his teaching and start writing violent novels. So we can't stop that. As long as there is greed for earning more, greed for higher profits, we can't stop that. But there should be at least a few people who should be able to write or create art without any mercenary motives. So let's start slowly. And we should do away with this copyright concept. The copyright doesn't benefit the writer, it benefits the publisher only, publisher and the bookseller. When our early writers, they even didn't mention their names when they wrote something, because they were not interested, they didn't care. Their urge was to create what was in their minds. So if maybe we could abolish copyright and go for copyleft or open source, probably we can create more Subhashita Sahitya that way. Okay. Why should
sir,
we sell
one
books?
Last question from Yati Patel, who wants to
know. Yeah.
Sir? This is the last question from Yati Patel, who wants to know how, what are the best teachings of history and how does history contribute to literature? Although it might be a long answer, but
I can make a very brief answer. History has been written throughout the world to please the ruling classes. History has always been written by the violent people, the people who waged war, who defeated others. So history has never been written by genuine people with loving kindness. I think we should forget our history totally, because we have only villains, we have only criminals made into heroes in our history. So we should look at history as what should never have been written, We should rewrite history as literature. That's what I'm trying to do in some of my historical novels.
Yes, thank you, sir. It was so.
But sir, I have a question here.
Yes.
Do you?
Yes, you see that we should actually forget history. I think, wouldn't it be better if we can accept that there are many histories rather than one grand narrative of history that is promoted by the establishment?
Yes.
That is in itself. That is in itself directed by the dominant ideology. Don't you think it would be better if we can allow other histories? Because history does not only mean killing. History doesn't only mean crime. History does not only mean the rise and fall of dynasties. History can also mean the real history of humankind, how they have progressed over the years.
Yeah, but Professor Amit, the problem is, up to now, we have never learned from our history. We have never learned a single lesson from our history. So it's better not to worry about it. If we can learn from our history, then yes, of course. Let's identify, let's analyze, let's research into our history, and let's try to learn from history. Let's try to learn what mistakes we have made and what good things we have done. And let's continue developing the good things that have happened in history and try not to repeat the bad things or the evil things that have happened throughout history.
Are there any other questions, Swami Pedro? Dr.
Yes, one more question has come in the meanwhile.
I see a question from Sayan Ganguly about commodified literature.
That you have said, I skipped that partially. I mean, of course, you
can always
comment on it. Yes.
Yeah.
And there's one last question from Sejal Jain. Of all the wars and conflicts, that isn't it because of the wars that we have advanced in our civilization? So only when issues are raised and fought against do we move forward in today's world. So progress comes from battles. Is that what you say?
What do you mean by progress? What do you mean by development, by civilization? Because now by progress, by development, we have always seen progress which leads to further greed, further violence, further conflicts. Because now every time there is a conflict, what happens is we develop things maybe for peaceful things, but then immediately they get turned into promoting violence. One example is nuclear power. Now the scientists who first worked on nuclear power would never have thought that it would create the atomic bomb or the nuclear bomb. So that is what happened. When we develop the wheel, we develop the wheel for transport of goods and for transport of people. But the wheel was used by people like Alexander to transport his armies. And the wheel was used in battle tanks, in armed vehicles. So that is what happens whenever we develop something. When even fire. Now fire, people would have discovered accidentally and found that it can be used to cook their food so that they can make the food tastier. But fire is used more often for destruction than for development throughout history. Fire is used to burn down books, burn down libraries. In Sri Lanka, we had a great library in the north, Jaffna. That Jaffna library was burnt down. So that is what fire has been used for. So everything that man has discovered, man has developed, has been used for violence and used against humanity, against nature. So that's why I always believe that development always means destruction. That man has always remained a Bhasmasura. And man has used his two hands mostly for destruction.
Yes, yes. So, thank you, sir. Yes, very much. Sir, some of our students are asking for your email ID. Can we have it here?
Pardon?
Sir, your email ID.
I will circulate it.
My email ID, WhatsApp number, the full paper I had prepared for today, I have shared with Professor Amit, so he can share it with anyone who wants, and I can respond to any questions by email or WhatsApp anytime. And we can continue this discussion in cyberspace always.
Okay. So if there are no other questions, I should now sum up the session. You see, it has really been wonderful having you with us, listening to you and listening to the questions that were raised and also your answers to them actually opened our eyes to various possibilities that only a literature could open our eyes to. You know, as one of the unacknowledged legislators of the world, you have actually given us a new perspective on things. So thank you for that. And I must end this discussion here and now at least. Obviously, we can continue it through cyberspace later on. We must end here by pointing out that we may always agree to disagree, but we should always disagree to disintegrate or discontinue communication. Thank you, Dayaji, for being with us and enlightening us in your own inimitable way. Thank you. And thank you, dear audience, for bearing with
thank
us.
Thank you. And namaskar. And hope to keep in touch in cyberspace with all of you. Thank you.